the ship of salvation. Ghareeb ya mazloom Karbala, ya laytana kunna ma'akum sayyidi fanafuza wallahi fawzan azeem. We wish we were with you so that we may fight in between your hands and gain martyrdom. Ah, peace be upon Qasim, son of Hassan. Peace be upon the Prince of Karbala. It is narrated that Imam al-Hussain entered upon his brother Imam al-Hassan when he was on his deathbed. When he stared at Imam al-Hassan, peace be upon him, he began weeping. Imam al-Hassan asked him, Aba Abdullah, why do you cry? He replied, I cry for what is happening to you. He replied, what is happening to me is that I've been poisoned and I will be killed because of this poison. But as for you, Aba Abdullah, there is no day like your day. La yawmaka yawmika ya Aba Abdullah. We still have 2 days and we'll hit that day. لا يومك يومك يا أبا عبد الله. 30,000 will gather against you, claiming to be from the nation of our grandfather. They will kill you, they will shed your blood and violate your sanctity. They will rob your belongings and take your women and children into captivity. The sky will rain blood because of your killing, and everything will cry for you, even the wild beasts of the desert, and even the fish in the sea. Imam, indeed, everything wept for Imam al-Hussain, peace be upon him. But no one wept as much as the household of Muhammad, especially Lady Fatima alayhi salam. Fatima, ya Fatima, ya Fatima. Lady Fatima, the one who attends the majalis of Imam al-Hussain wherever they are upheld, as if she says, Wallah ana al-walda, ana al-walda, mazbuh ibn ha, ibn ha. I am the mother whose son was slaughtered. Ibn ha, never has my sorrow reduced. Wallah sab'een, sab'een bdur, bdur bil ma'raka janha. She says, I see 70 bodies shining like bright moons. Wallah sab'een jitha bdur janha. These 70 were left on the plains of Karbala. No one buried them for 3 consecutive days. What else worries you, O Fatima? Wallah zin What worries me is that Zainab is taken into captivity and the enemies are taking Zainab away from Karbala. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون. الله سبحانه لقرآن فلينظر الإنسان إلى طعامه. The Ahl al-Bayt, peace be upon him, peace be upon them, give a lot of attention to the youth days. and they give a lot of attention to the youths themselves, because they consider the youth to be the future and to be a very important component of society. For this reason, the narration of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him and his family, says, on the day of judgment, no one will be able to move his legs or her legs until he or she is asked about four things. First of all, he shall be asked about his life. How did he spend his life? Where did you spend your life? What did you do during your life? Second of all, he will be asked about his youth days. What did he do when he was young? Was he in the mosque? Was he in the Husayniyah, in the majalis of Imam al-Husayn like you are today? Or was he in the bars, in the nightclubs, and the concerts? Thirdly, he will be asked about his money. How did he acquire his money? Was it through halal, a halal job, or a haram job? And secondly, where did he place the money? As in, did he use it for the right reasons? Did he pay his zakat and his khums? Did he look after the poor? Or did he look only after himself? And last but not least, he will be asked about our love, Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them. Was he from the lovers of the Ahlul Bayt or was he not? Was he from the enemies or was he not? Did he have any hatred towards them? If he had love, did his love translate into action? Or did the love not translate into action? On that they realize Allah asks a general question about what to do about your life, but then there's a specific question about your youth days. Why, O Allah, do you ask us about these days? Why not? Why don't you ask us about the days when we're old? Because these days are very crucial, very important. The question is, what are we supposed to do when we're young? What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala await from us when we're young? What does He want us to do? If you skim through the narrations of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, you find that there are two deeds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would like a youth to perform. The first one is seeking knowledge. Read the book Mizan al-Hikmah and see how important it is to seek knowledge. I do not know truly where to start and where to end concerning seeking knowledge. We've discussed a few nights ago the narration of the Prophet where he said, peace be upon him and his family, seek knowledge from the cradle to the grave. However, there is a lot of attention given to religious knowledge. You can learn mathematics, you can learn history, you can learn physics. That's very nice, very good. However, the Ahlul Bayt expect you to give some attention, actually a lot of attention, to your religion, learning the tafsir of the Quran, learning the tafsir of the ahadith of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, Islamic history, jurisprudence, beliefs, theology, so on and so forth. To the extent that you see the Ahlul Bayt who have ultimate mercy, like Imam al-Sadiq, peace be upon him, who is the merciful Imam, who is the walking, talking Muhammad bin Abdullah. He goes to the point of saying, لَيْتَ الصِّيَاطَ عَلَى رُؤُسْ أَصْحَابِي. I wish the whips were over the heads of my companions. Why, O Imam? You're merciful. Why do you want whips to be over their heads? He says, because I want them to understand, to learn and understand the religion. People usually tend to stay away from this topic. They tend to stay away from learning their ahkam, from learning their jurisprudence. They fall into numerous problems because of their ignorance in jurisprudence. As an example, when a person gets married, usually he does not read about the Islamic laws on marriage. We have hundreds of pages about the laws on marriage and the rights of a wife over her husband, the rights of a husband over his wife, but subhanAllah, only a few read them. For this reason, you see two people get married, later on, tens of problems happen, they come back to the Shaykh or the Sayyid Mawlana, fix our problem. Why did you not read before you got married to understand your rights, to understand the morals, the akhlaq of marriage, and how you're supposed to behave? Imam al-Sadiq says, I wish The whips were over the heads of my companions, so that they may learn and understand their religion. As for the Prophet, peace be upon him and his family, he goes to the extent of saying that if you become a seeker of knowledge, you become a person who's seeking the knowledge of Islam, the angels, alayhi salam, place their wings under your feet. They let you walk on their wings. They're proud of you. They consider you more important than them. Everything in this world starts to do istighfar, to seek forgiveness for you, if you gave a little bit of attention to religion. If we look at the youth today, unfortunately, with all due respect to everyone, we give a lot of attention to NHL, NBA, NFL. But to religion, we don't give that much attention. If I ask you, name me the 12 Imams, alayhim as-salam, maybe a handful of you will tell me, yes, their names are Ali, Hassan, Hussein, to Imam al-Mahdi. But if I ask you, who is the best NBA player, he would be? Jayed. Or the best NHL player, he would be? Ahsan, Jazakumullah khair. So my point was proven. We do not give enough attention to Islamic history, to Islam. The Prophet tells us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O youth, learn when you're young, because when you're learning as you are young, it is as if you're carving on stone. When you carve something on stone, it's permanent. When you learn the Quran and you memorize it as a child, for example, you will not forget it. It will be carved in your mind, in your memory. Rather, he says, if you learn when you're old, which is also good, but it has its hardships, it has its troubles. If you learn when you're old, it's as if you're writing on water, meaning you tend to forget. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi does not want to shut the door in anyone's face, even if he's old. This is why he also says, if a person did not learn when he was young, but he chose to learn that when he was old, and dies, he will receive the thawab of a martyr. He will receive the reward of a martyr. He will be considered a martyr in the eyes of the Almighty Allah Ta'ala. The Quran, on the other hand, tells us, فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِهِ. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِهِ. Let the human being look at his food. What is the relationship between this verse and between knowledge? Allah is talking about food. Allah is telling you, look at your food. Because if you look at your food and you ponder about it, and you ponder about the stages this food had to go through until it reached you, you will see that there is a mudabbir, there's a Lord who is managing the affairs of this world. However, the Imams take you to a spiritual journey. They tell you, don't think that the Quran is only what you see. Don't think that the Quran is only these words, the surface that you see. The Quran, every verse in the Quran has 7 hidden meanings. Another narration says 70 hidden meanings, 70 deeper meanings. And so Imam al-Baqir tells us, when Allah says, أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُ الْإِنسَانِ فَلْيَنْظُرُ الْإِنسَانِ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِهِ, he means to say, let him look at his knowledge. What is he learning? Who is he learning from? Who's my teacher? What kind of thoughts am I placing in my mind? As in the Quran tells you, there is food for your stomach, and then there's food for your soul, for your mind. Make sure that you are learning the proper ideas, and you're learning from the proper person. Who should my main teacher be? I'm not talking about the teacher of mathematics, or physics, or history. I'm talking the teacher that will affect my beliefs, that will affect my morals, my practices. He should be one who takes his knowledge from the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Do you remember the lecture on Marja'iyya? What did the Imam say, Imam al-Sadiq? He said, go to Abu Basir. Imam al-Rida said, go to Zakariya bin Adam. Imam al-Hadi said, go to Abdul Azim al-Hasani. Why these people? Because they have been spoon-fed by who? By the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salat wa-salam. What is realized today, brothers and sisters, is that we will be affected by Western teachers who hold an ideology that contradicts our belief. As in, I will enter, for example, philosophy class, and I will learn about Western philosophers, and my ideology becomes the ideology of these philosophers, not the ideology of the Ahlul Bayt. The Imam tells you, watch out. فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانِ إِلَىٰ طَهَامِهِ Imam al-Hassan is amazed. He says, I'm amazed from a person who will be careful, who will be cautious what he eats. He will be cautious about what he eats. You won't eat any food. You'll make sure it's healthy food because you do not want to fall sick. But he does not watch out. Where is he getting his knowledge from? He does not care what is he learning. What ideas are going through his spirit? Subhanallah. Imam Ali says, on the other hand, I am amazed of a person who is offered food at night and does not eat until he brings a lantern. Until he lights up a lantern. Why? To see the food, to make sure it's healthy food. It's proper to eat. But he does not enlighten his mind in order to make sure he's not learning anything false. He's only learning what will push him towards guidance, what will guarantee his happiness. I'll give you a very important example. Today, some of us might be affected by certain ideas that are out there, to the extent where you'll have some youth tell you, I cannot see what is wrong with homosexuality, God forbid. I cannot see what is wrong with being gay or being lesbian. I'm talking about a Shia youth. I'm not talking about a youth who's not Shia or not Muslim. A Shia youth will come up and tell you, I cannot see what is the matter with this concept. فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانِ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِهِ Have you watched out for your knowledge? Who are you being affected by? Who are you learning from? Did you open the Quran and see what is the idea, what is the Quran's opinion about homosexuality? Or the Ahlul Bayt's opinion, alayhim as-salam? Have you opened Nahj al-Balagha, al-Kafi, man la yahdaruhu al-faqih, Bihar al-Anwar, Basair al-Darajat? Have you opened these books? Uyun akhbar al-Rida? No, they're left for the dust, as if the dust has to read them. But we have not, we don't open them with all due respect. What is wrong with the concept of homosexuality? The first thing wrong with it is that it contradicts human nature. With all due respect to everyone, this is a free country, and we have the right to, we have the freedom of speech, we have the right to present our thoughts, our religion, our ideas. We're not attacking anyone. But the first thing is that it contradicts human nature. In fact, it contradicts nature in itself. Look at the animal kingdom. What will you see? A lion mates with a lioness, not with another lion. A stallion will mate with a mare, not with another stallion. You will see that a male cat will mate with a female cat. Even if you go to chemistry, subhanAllah, and you go into the science of atoms, you will realize the atom has three main parts. What are they, brothers? Proton, neutron, electron. MashaAllah, you've learned your chemistry. Jayid. So now, the protons will not come by other protons. They will repel. They will not be attracted to each other. The electrons won't be attracted to each other. Rather, it is the opposite that attracts the opposite. Meaning, the electron that is attracted to the protons. This is nature. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created nature in this way. He has created the male to be attracted to the female and vice versa, so that they may marry and humanity can continue. Some will even tell you, I cannot see. They're so affected by these thoughts and ideas. They tell you, I cannot see where it's haram in the Quran, where it says it's haram to be gay or lesbian, subhanAllah. Have we read the Quran? Let me ask you a question. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep on reminding us about the story of Lut alayhi salam? Lut was not one of the main five prophets, the five top prophets. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps on mentioning his story with the rest of the prophets. Out of all prophets, there are 124,000 prophets. Allah chooses Lut's story to be mentioned not once or twice, frequently mentioned in the Quran. What happened with Lut alayhi salam? Look into the story. Lut comes up to his people, as the Quran tells us. He says to them, وَلُوطًا إِذْ قَالَ لِقَوْمِهِ إِنَّكُمْ لَتَأْتُونَ الْفَاحِشَةِ مَا سَبَقَكُمْ بِهَا مِنْ أَحَدٍ مِنَ الْعَالَمِينَ You are indeed doing a fahisha. You are doing what is very indecent and hideous. You are the first group of people to do this deed, which means that the people of Lut were the first group on the face of the earth to be gay, a'udhu billah, and to be lesbians. Lut told them, alayhi salam, what are you doing? What are you doing? You are cutting off your progeny. This is one of the proofs that it's wrong to be gay or lesbian. That he's saying you're cutting off your offspring. If a man mates with a man, he cannot have a child. If a female mates with a female, they cannot have a child. Why is that? Because as we said, it contradicts human nature. He tells them, what are you doing? You're cutting off your offspring. What do they reply to him? They tell him, bring us the punishment of God if you are truthful. Mocking Lut alayhi salam. That if you are really a prophet of God, and what you're saying is true, we should get punished. Since we're not getting punished, then that means we're not wrong. Subhanallah. They forgot that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the human being a chance to repent. And God does not usually descend his punishment directly. Look at Pharaoh, for example. How many chances did Pharaoh get before receiving his punishment, before drowning? Allah gave him signs and signs. He sent him multiple signs before finally destroying him. Because Allah سَبَقَتْ رَحْمَتُهُ غَضَبًا Allah is more merciful. He's a merciful Lord. More than being a Lord that punishes his servants. He gave them a chance, yet they did not answer. The Quran tells us the angels came to Lut alayhi salam. Before that, they went to Ibrahim. They gave Ibrahim the good news that, oh Ibrahim, you are going to receive a son, and his name is Ishaq. He was an old man, and his wife Sarah was also very old. It was a miracle. Allah will bless you with Ishaq, and after Ishaq, Yaqub. Now, oh Ibrahim, we're going to the people of Lut because we're going to destroy them. Ibrahim told them, Lut is there. They told him, we know who is there. We will save him and his family, except for his wife. Imagine. She backstabbed Lut alayhi salam. She was a disbeliever in God subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a lesson in itself. When you have a wife of a prophet who enters hellfire, subhanallah, which proves the point that being with the prophet or the imam with your body is not enough. You need to be with them with your souls. And this is why yesterday we said Rasulullah said about the likes of you that you are his brothers. He said, they told him, who are your brothers? He said, people who will come in the last era. You have not seen him. You have not been with him. They will come in the last era and they will believe in me. So some of them will wish to see me, even if it's that's by a dream. Don't you wish to see the Prophet by your dream? Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. So he was talking about you, but you did not meet him. This is a big lesson for everyone. Now, so they told him that we're going to Lut alayhi salam, we're going to save his family. They came to Lut, but in what form? They came in the form of handsome men as the guests of Lut salamullah alayhi. When Lut saw them, he was very disturbed. Why? Because he knew his people. They were very indecent. And so he was disturbed, and he wanted to protect these guests. The men of the people of Lut came to his house. They wanted to abuse his own guests. Here there's a dialogue that the Quran tells us. He began defending his guests. He told them, these are my daughters, marry my daughters. They said, no. The angels turned to Lut. They told him, do not worry. Do not fear anymore. Do not feel saddened. The order of Allah has come. They told him, we are angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you must leave this place. You and your family, but leave your wife behind because they will be destroyed. The narrations tell us that the angels were Jibra'il, Mika'il, Israfil, and Azra'il alayhim salam. They came. They had a command from Allah to raise the land of Lut salamullahi alayhi, after Lut had departed. And they kept it high in the sky to the extent that the narrations say, the residents of the sky, the angels, could hear the dogs of that village barking. Then when the order of Allah came, they flipped it upside down and crushed the people of Lut alayhi salam. Did it end here? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shot them with stones. He's stoning them. Now tell me, is this enough to believe that being gay or lesbian is haram? Or is it not enough? We need to see the verse saying, Al-liwatu haram. Subhanallah. The story is enough. Allah destroyed a whole group of people to tell you, oh people, oh Muslims, don't even think about this deed. Stay away. I detest it completely. So sometimes, brothers and sisters, we are influenced by our surroundings to the extent that we learn the ideas that contradict the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. You need to learn the Ahlul Bayt's ideas. You need to look into their books. Before studying philosophy, you need to have a good understanding of Islamic theology. Or else if you go to philosophy, I will not guarantee that you come out as a believer. With all due respect. It's like a battlefield. If there's a battle between two armies, would you walk in between? Would you? You wouldn't. It's crazy, right or wrong? Similarly, if you go into philosophy class without having a good understanding of your beliefs, of the proofs of these beliefs, will you come out as a mu'min? Allahu alam. I hope you do. I really hope you do. Sallu ala Muhammad. The second deed that is stressed upon is worshiping when you are a youth, when you're a young boy or young girl, young man, young woman. The narration tells us from the Prophet that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he sees a young man worshiping him, he boasts to his angels. He tells them, look at my slave, look at my servant. He has refrained from his desires. He has hormones, he has desires. He has refrained from his desires and has chosen to worship me. On the day of judgment, everyone will be gathered on that day. From Adam till the last human being. Imam Ali says, alayhi salam, when the people are gathered, the person who has the best state on that day is the person who can find a spot for himself to stand. Because there's so much people. And they're right beside each other. If you went to Ziyarah in Arba'een, or you've went to Hajj and you've done Tawaf beside the Kaaba, right beside it, you'll know what Imam Ali is talking about, alayhi salam. When you have so much people gathered, the narration says that they're all sweating, it's a hot day, to the extent that the sweat reaches their earlobes. It's that high. So the people are standing with their heads up. On that day, seven people will be granted the privilege of being under a shadow created by Allah. One of those people is the young man or the young woman who obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he's young, when he worships Allah ta'ala. Let us go to Qasim ibn al-Hasan, salamullah alayhi. Qasim is an individual that had immense knowledge. We don't have much information about him, but we can tell from a few instances of his life that he's a person with certainty, belief, immense knowledge, and a person willing to make the greatest sacrifice for God subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for his knowledge, you can tell that he has immense knowledge from his stance on the night of Ashura. On the night of Ashura, Qasim alayhi salam asks Abu Abdullah, uncle, will I be martyred tomorrow with you? Will I be from those who are killed? How do you think Imam al-Hussein is supposed to break the news to a young man, to a young boy who's not even 15 years old? Some say he was 14. He did not even reach the stage of puberty yet. Imam al-Hussein told him, how do you find the taste of death? He told him, I found it sweeter than honey. Subhanallah. Let me pose a question to you. You're told that tonight is the last night in your life. Suppose
By tomorrow morning, you're dead. How would you feel? Would you be crying? I know I would. Would you be scared? Would you be doing tawbah? When Qasim heard that tomorrow will be the day of his killing, not the day of his death only, the day of his killing, istabshar. He became happy. Subhanallah. This is a man with immense knowledge, a boy, but who is a man in his heart. Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. He understood this life. He understood the afterlife and understood that this life is the jail of the mu'min, and that when he leaves it, it's as if you're leaving jail. Imagine, you've been in prison for 50 years and they tell you today, Mawlana, today you come out of jail. How would you be feeling? Qasim understood this life is a jail and that the afterlife is heaven. Imam al-Hassan, one day he's walking in front of a Jew. The Jewish man was going through a hard time in his life. Very poor, going through a lot of hardship. Imam al-Hassan, on the other hand, was very well off. He has a beautiful clothing, a good animal that he is riding. The Jewish man came up to him. He told him, your grandfather Rasulullah said once that the world, this world, is the prison of the believer and the heaven of the disbeliever. And he said that the afterlife is the prison of the disbeliever and the heaven of the believer, right or wrong? Imam Hassan said, yes, indeed. He said, I see the exact opposite. You're well off, and I'm having a hard time in my life. Imam Hassan told him, listen, what the Prophet meant, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, is that the mu'min's life, even if he's very well off in this life, even if he is living the life of luxury, he's in a mansion, the afterlife, when compared to this life, is like comparing heaven to a prison. Because he's going to somewhere much better, much nicer, much more peaceful. Rather, the disbeliever, because his ultimate fate is what? Jahannam, it's hellfire. Whatever he goes through in this life, even if he's going through a bad state, this is heaven for him when compared to the afterlife. So Qasim understood that this life is the prison of the mu'min. Next, what did he do as a ibadah? He did the greatest form of ibadah on the day of Ashura. When defending Imam al-Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, although the enemies had not seen him, when Imam al-Hussein mobilized his army, which you will hear on the day of Ashura, they did not see Qasim salamullah alayhi, because he was young. But when Imam al-Hussein's companions were killed, and his family members, some of them were killed, Imam al-Hussein began calling out, wa ghurbata, wa qillata nasira. We only have a few supporters. Is there not anyone who will come and help us? Is there not anyone who will come and support us? Is there not anyone who will come and defend us? Qasim alayhi salatu wasalam came to Aba Abdullah, peace be upon him. He asked for permission. When Imam al-Hussein saw him, they hugged and they began crying until they fell unconscious. This is the only instance in Karbala you'll see where two people, where Imam Hussein and one of his family members, they fall unconscious. They fell. When they regained consciousness, Qasim alayhi salam said to Imam Hussein, he said to him, oh uncle, he sought permission. Imam did not give him permission. He told him, oh uncle, I cannot bear to live when I see my cousins and my brothers, they have been killed in front of me. And you are all alone with no supporters. Still Imam al-Hussein did not give him permission. He told him, "Anta al-Wadi'a, you are the trust of my brother Hassan." Imam al-Hassan entrusted Imam al-Hussein with Qasim before leaving this world. You are the trust of my brother. How can I give you permission to go? Knowing that you will be killed. Qasim alayhi salam kept on kissing Imam Hussein's hands and feet, begging him, please give me permission. He told him, oh son, oh nephew, are you going to walk to your own death? He said, oh uncle, how can I not do so? When I see that you have been surrounded by your enemies, you have no helper,
You have no supporter, may I be sacrificed for you. روحي لروحك الفداء ونفسي لنفسك الوقاء.
Imam al-Hussein still did not give him permission. Subhanallah.
Qasim felt a lot of pain in his heart. He felt a lot of sorrow. He was very worried. But he remembered, my father Hassan once gave me a piece of paper. And he tied it to my body. He told me, Bunay Qasim, do not open this letter until you feel severe distress. Days passed and Qasim did not feel any distress until the day of Ashura. He felt what Imam al-Hassan had mentioned. And so Qasim alayhi salam opened the paper and saw the writing of Imam al-Hassan, peace be upon him. What did Imam al-Hassan say to Qasim? He said, Bunay Qasim, my son Qasim, if you see your grandfather, if you see your uncle Hussein in Karbala, alone with no supporters, then do not show any shortcoming in his support. Imam al-Hussein, peace be upon him, called again, is there not anyone who will come and support us? Qasim heard the call of Abu Abdullah. He rejoiced, he felt happy to see the writing of his father Hassan alayhi salam. And so it is said he came to Imam al-Hussein calling out, Labbaik, Labbaik, Ha'ana Bayna Yadayk. I am at your service, Abu Abdullah. Salawatullahi alayk. May Allah's blessings descend upon you. Na'am, Imam al-Hussein was brought the letter. When he looked at the letter of Imam al-Hassan, he began weeping. I ask you, Abu Abdullah, why are you weeping? Did you remember Abu Muhammad al-Hassan? Are you weeping because you remembered how he turned green and how he vomited his liver into pieces? Na'am, Imam al-Hussein wept and finally gave permission to Qasim alayhi salam in order to descend to the battlefield. But before descending, he called Zainab salamullahi alayha, telling Zainab to bring the box of Imam al-Hassan, a box that held certain items that Imam al-Hassan would wear. Na'am, Zainab brought the box to Imam al-Hussein. He took out the turban of Hassan, placed it on the head of Qasim salamullahi alayhi. He took out the robe of Imam al-Hassan and he let Qasim wear that robe. Qasim would resemble his father. And so when the women saw him, it's as if they saw Imam al-Hassan walking in Karbala, subhanallah. As if Abu Muhammad has returned to the world to defend Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. The women surrounded Qasim. One of them was kissing him, the other was smelling him, the third was bidding farewell to Qasim. Na'am, there was an uproar in the tent of Imam al-Hussein for Imam al-Hassan and for Qasim. I do not know what is the state of Ramla. How is she feeling on that day? But it is as if I hear her say to Qasim alayhi salam, Ya Bni Ya Jasim, Hal وكيت حالك لعمك ظنه يا ابني يا جاسم هل وكيت حالك لعمك ظنه انا ذا خرتك هل وكيت بالك تخيب ظنوني. She tells him, Qasim, I have raised you. Qasim, I've prepared you for this day. Thus support your uncle. all. Give it everything you have, my son. حز الرماح وتكلى يا والدة تدعيني أنا رايح يا والدة رايح أنا يا والدة من غير ما تقليني. He told her mother pray for me. Mother, I am going to defend my uncle without you even telling me. عمي وحيد بكربلاء لمن أضم الحالي انت وعمتي زيانة لما الأخير الخوني. He told her mother, mother, Ramla, my uncle is all alone in Karbala. If I do not support him, who will I support? Mother, when I charge at the enemies, I want you in my heart, Zainab, to encourage me. However, mother, I have one last will. What is your will of Qasim? Listen to the will of Qasim, O youth. Walida, ya walida. تسمعين اللفظ جوابي. Listen to my wallow mother Amla. شبان لو شفتيهم يما اذكر شبابي يما اذكر شبابي. Mother, if you see a group of youth, remember your young Qasim in Karbala. أنا محروم من شم الهوى من دون كل أصحابي. عطشان أنا يا والدة والله عطشان أنا يا والدة وقت الشرب ذكريني. Mother Amla, when you drink, remember me, because I have departed from this world thirsty. Indeed, Qasim descended the battlefield. The enemies began asking, some of them asked, who is this young boy? Does Hussein have another son we do not know of? Have we not killed Ali Akbar? And so Qasim wanted to tell them who he is. He replied in poetry, ابتني كريمي فأنا نجل الحسن صبت النبي المصطفى والمؤتمن. If you do not know who I am, I will tell you. I am the son of Hassan, the grandson of the prophet, the chosen prophet of God. هذا حسين كالأسير المرتد بين أناس لا سقوط صوب المزن. This is Hussein like a captain between people. I ask Allah not to descend his rain upon such people. Naam Qasim descended. Hamid bin Muslim says, I saw a young boy come towards us. He had a sword in his hand and he was wearing two sandals. His face was so beautiful, it was as if he was part of the moon. Qasim descended and was fighting like a warrior. Although he was 14, they were not able to defeat him. He killed 35 horsemen. But as Qasim is fighting, his shoelace snaps. Qasim bends down to fix his shoelace, forgetting about all the enemies because he does not care about them. Naam, as he bent down, Amr al-Azdi الأسد والله لا أشدن عليه. I swear by Allah, I will charge at him. Hamid said to him, why would you do so? If he attacked me, I would not attack back. He has been surrounded by enemies. They will suffice you. He said, والله لا أفعلن. I swear by Allah, I will do it. أجركم الله. As a Qasim is fixing his shoelace, he gives him a blow to his head. Qasim calls out, Ya Allah, Uncle Hussein, come to my rescue. The narration says he comes like an eagle. He strikes Amr on his hand and severs his arm. The horsemen of Ibn Sa'd try to rescue Amr, but they end up killing him as the horses trample and they pound Amr. If you were present on that day, what would you see? Na'am dadassaru. Imam al-Hussein is standing beside Qasim, whose head is open. I can picture the blood on his face, the blood on the sand of Karbala. And Qasim alayhi salam is moving his hands and legs in the sand of Karbala. Imam al-Hussein says to him, Azza wa Allah ala amrik, anta ad'uuh fala yujibuk. It is dear to your uncle that you call him, but he does not respond to you. Ayujibuk fala yu'inuk, or he responds, but he does not help you. Ayu'inuk fala yu'inuk, or he comes to help you, but he cannot do anything for you. Away with people who have killed you. The adversary will be your grandfather and your father on the day of judgment. هذا يوم والله كثر واتره وقل ناصره. يا جاسم بجي نادى يا جاسم شبيبي. The poet says Imam al-Hussein cried and said, Jasim, Qasim is not in my hands. Wallah ya rayat al-sif qablak hazred. Qasim, I wished I was beheaded before I see your killing. Wallah alaykum ya waladi tatarkun wahad. Is it easy for you, Qasim, and for your family members to leave Hussein? Ah, when khayal ya ammi ala khayammi tafatar. Qasim, can you not see how my enemies have surrounded me? Imam al-Hussein picked up Qasim. Hamid says, I was watching Hussein. He placed the chest of Qasim on his chest and he took him back to the tent. I said to myself, what is Hussein doing? I realized that the legs of Qasim were dragging on the ground. Allahu Akbar. Aba Abdullah, Aba Abdullah, you are the son of Ali. Ali was able to open the gates of Khaybar with one hand. Why is it that you cannot pick up your nephew Qasim? Naam, Imam al-Hussein was devastated. Imam al-Hussein had no more energy to even pick up Qasim alayhi salam. And so he brought him back to the tents, as if I see him putting him beside Ali al-Akbar. Naam, sitting between the two, he looks at Ali. He calls out, Wa walada, Wa Aliya. He looks at Qasim. He calls out, Wa Qasim. Ah, Jabba. it says he brought him beside his brothers and began weeping for them as they lie dead. لما نسمع عن النسوان صوتا اجت رملة صيح الله أكبر. When the women heard Imam Hussain's voice, they came, he says, Ramla called out, Allahu Akbar, my son, what have they done to you? Indeed, what do you think, Ramla? How is Ramla feeling to see Qasim in that state? How is Zainab feeling, Salamullah alayha? As if Ramla says to Qasim, Wallah yabni, الهدم ذاك البنات يا ابناء يا ابناء يا جاسم ليش قطعتني يا ابناء يا ابناء قاسم يا ابناء في مظلم باي حسين يا ابناء تبقى وياي الذنب بي يا ابني. My son, I thought you would remain with me until I grow old. And once I grow old, you will take care of me, Qasim. يا ابني تباريني لما انتبنا المنية. All together, that was called for Qasim عليه السلام. والله تباريني لما انتبنا جسام يا ابن ردك ما رد الدنيا ولا ما. As if she tells him, my son, I wanted you in this world. I did not want anything else. I did not want money or possessions. You were my only wish, oh Qasim. نعم Imam Hussain عليه السلام then raised his face to the sky, supplicating to Allah. اللهم احصهم عددا واقتلهم بددا ولا تغادر منهم احدا. Oh Allah, divide them. Oh Allah, destroy them all. Do not leave anyone from them. Patience, oh my cousins. He directed his speech to his cousins. Patience, oh my cousins. Patience, oh my household. You will not see any disgrace after today. This was Qasim alayhi salam. He had another brother, Abdullah al-Asghar, whose story is also very tragic. And so it is right upon us to recite what happened to him tonight. When Imam al-Hussain alayhi salam was surrounded by his enemies, Abdullah al-Asghar came out to see his uncle. He looked at Imam al-Hussain, saw him surrounded. Ajarakum Allah. Zainab was trying to keep him with her, but he ran away. Why? He saw Bahr bin Ka'b wanting to strike Imam al-Hussain with the sword. And so he ran. He ran until he got close to the Imam. He said, oh son of the ruthless lady, do you want to attack my uncle? And so he stretched his hand, and Bahr struck the hand of Abdullah. He severed his hand, but it remained connected with his arm through the skin. Allahu Akbar. He said, Ya Allah, uncle, they severed my hand. He fell into Imam Hussein's lap. Imam al-Hussain said, patience, have patience, my nephew. Consider it a reward, consider this tragedy to be part of your reward in the hereafter. Allah will take you to your forefathers. Then Imam al-Hussain alayhi salam began supplicating to Allah ta'ala. Allahumma in matta'tahum ila ففرقهم تفريقا. Oh Allah, if you've delayed their punishment, then please divide them, turn them into smithereens. Do not let the rulers be pleased with them ever, for they called us to support us, and then they transgressed against us and killed us. أجركم الله as Abdullah is in Imam Hussein's lap. حرمل الشوت عبد الله أيوة سيده with an arrow. Abdullah started in the lap of Imam Hussein. I ask, what does an uncle feel when his own nephew, his own flesh and blood is slaughtered in his hands? Surrounded again. Allahu Akbar. I ask Aba Abdullah one last question. Sayyidi Qasim called you on the day of Ashura. He said, Ya Allah, and you came to him. Abbas called you, he said, Adrikni Ya Akhi, and you came to him. Ali Al Akbar called you, and you came to him. But is it fair, Aba Abdullah, that at your last see Shimmer sitting on your chest with his sword? Who is beside you, Ya Aba Abdullah? Who is there to protect you, Ya Hussein? ولزينب النوحون لفقد شقيقها تدعوه يا ابن الزاكيات الركعين. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون.